started first with a Look, you guys are interrupting Walt Disney. Did I call that?
Yeah, you did.
Thank you. So the wizard Merlin will give you a quick lecture on project management, and then I'll pick up where he leaves off. So important to plan all the details before you begin working on your project. In this case, he's having a project to move. Some of you may recognize these things in your team. You get some team conflict. You gotta make sure you control your team as project manager. All right, so it's a little silly video put together by another university about project management, but it does give you a little kind of relationship to the chaos you'll see in project management. So within any given project, there will be a lot of humming in the room. There will be a lot of chaos in your projects, okay? So as a project manager, your goal is to minimize the chaos, right? Keep the entropy down, try and keep everybody in the team moving the same way. Well, next week, we'll just get started maybe 5 minutes late to give the half of you that can't make it in time a chance. So your goal is just try and keep the craziness down, keep everybody pulling in the same direction, okay? How many of you are project managers for your team? A few. How many of you are design leads? Anybody? How many of you are neither one? Okay, good. So not that many of you. Hi. Good. Make sure you grab a Scantron and get your name filled out. They're floating around somewhere. Looks like there's a few back there. All right, so next week, let's try and make sure everybody gets here a little closer to on time, please. Next week, let's try and make sure everybody gets here a little closer to on time, please. Thank you. Wrong room? Okay. It's this one. It'll be this one all semester, so any of these lectures, make sure you show up here. So I was talking about chaos and things being out of control, I think, something like that. So. Further examples of that, people showing up to the wrong room or late. So some of these things are why we need project management. So some of the things I want you to learn today are, why do we need project management? What's the point? Why don't we just jump in? We'll be agile. We'll just jump right in and get to work, and we'll deal with problems when they arise. Hi. Were you in the wrong room too?
No?
You just got lost? Okay. So another thing is how to scope a project. So you'll find this is really important as you go through and manage projects. So those of you who aren't your design lead or project manager, you will be on some project at some point in your career, I promise. Especially if you're in engineering, you're going to be in that role, absolutely, for sure. You're going to learn how to create and maintain a Gantt chart. So that's just one of many tools for creating a timeline for your project. But more importantly than creating a timeline is keeping people accountable to a timeline. So a timeline itself is not really much use if you just create it and then you set it aside and you don't come back to it. So we'll talk a little bit about how to hold people accountable, and I'll go through a lengthy example on how to create a Gantt chart. I'll show you one tool, it's called Project Libre. It's really kind of a copy of Microsoft Project. We have Project on all the lab computers, but you do have to pay for it if you want it on your own. So I'm using Project Libre because it's open source, so you guys can all get it for free. And then we'll talk a little bit about PIGS. How many of you have done PIGS in the first couple weeks in your classes? Some. Those of you who aren't, how do your advisors keep you accountable? Some of you didn't raise your hand. You guys. Yeah.
Oh, I personally never did it. We sent all our information to one person and they implemented it.
So you do PIGS as a class?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay,
cool. All right, well, we'll talk about those a little bit. Again, it's just one tool. I advise three teams. One team, we don't do PIGS. The other two, we do. And that just depends on the structure of the team. So I think those of you who don't know me, I'm a biomedical engineer by training. I worked in the orthopedic industry for 5 years before I came back here. I'm your lab manager now. So I worked in a regulated industry. So the government said you had to follow certain procedures if you wanted to sell a device. If you didn't follow those procedures, you weren't allowed to sell your device. They'd pull it off the market and basically put you out of business. Okay, that's really bad. So you don't want that. So you had to be really strict on the design process. But that design process is what you should be using in any other industry as well. So these are the things that you'll need to know. So I follow the concepts through design documentation, okay? So project management is the first step. You have to say what this project is, how we're going to keep everybody, you know, what are the personnel that we need to do the project, what is the timeline. From there, we'll talk about design inputs. So this is anything that goes into the design. So these would be your user needs, your specifications, all that work you do up front before you get into creating your design, your solution. So it's what is that problem? You then have design outputs. So that is, I've designed something and here's what I created. So you kind of go, in documentation, you kind of go from before design to after design. Like, here's what I created in my design. The actual act of making a design is a sort of spontaneous mental process. So you set yourself up for success with your design inputs. You create something and you record it in your design outputs, and that inspiration or spark in the middle is your actual design. So we'll talk about both of those in lecture. So the next two lectures will focus on design inputs. So we'll talk first about user needs. So user needs are sort of the broad goals of a project. So we'll talk about a kite. If you have a kite, your user needs might be it should fly. But that couldn't be the only one because a paper airplane flies, but it's not a kite, right? So maybe it needs to be tethered to the ground as well. So that's kind of when we talk about user needs, it's those, what are the big features of this project? And then the next lecture on the 21st of September, we'll talk about specifications. So that's when we take those big user needs, so that kind of broad idea of what the project should do, and we put it into quantifiable terms. So engineering terms that you can measure, that you can hold yourself accountable to. Hi. So those are some of the things we'll talk about in the next couple of lectures if you come to those. And then in November, when we pick up, we'll talk about design outputs. So design outputs are sort of the product of your design effort. So that's when we'll have things like CAD models, circuit diagrams, sketches, things like that, okay? So all the things you need to do to take that idea you had and bring it into reality. So those are design outputs. We'll talk about those later. On the 28th, right before mid-semester design review, we'll talk about design reviews, how to do public speaking presentations. Most of it is on how to just calm down and relax so that you can act like a human in front of other people. It's kind of fun. So we take our design review talk, we take from a lot of information from the Second City in Chicago. I don't know if any of you have been to any of their shows. It's an improv comedy group, but they also do corporate training. So they do some training on how to public speak kind of in an ad hoc fashion. So you're standing up in front of a crowd and someone throws something at you. How do you take it and handle it and give it back? So that's a really fun one. And then again, in the second half of the semester, in November, we'll talk about verification and validation. So those are what we broadly would consider testing of a device. So verification will look at, did we make this thing right? Does it work? Will it not break in the way we want it to? Validation is, did we make the right thing? So that's when we go back and look at our user needs and we say, did we really satisfy this need? Okay. Did we really give them what they needed? Even though it works, it might not be the right product. Okay. A lot of the times in consumer products, when you have a complaint, it's because they didn't do very good validation. So they know their product worked, but it just didn't work the way you wanted it to. The next thing in a commercial product would be design transfer. So that's where you take that design that you made and you're transferred into mass production. Okay, you're gonna make this thing. We won't do that in EPICS because none of you mass produce things in general. If you do, if you have a project that you think you will do that, come and talk to me. I'd be happy to help you with it. But be aware when you leave here and you're doing products and industry, those will go through a transfer. And there are engineers that spend their career just working on product transfer. Okay, and then design changes. So we think we've designed this thing, we've delivered it, and we're done. But really you have changes. Every commercial product has changes. And you need to control those changes so that devices in the market work the way they're supposed to. So as you can imagine, if you have a part in an automobile that you change, and then someone buys that part and puts it in their car, it better work the right way, okay? So you have to look at the interfaces. Does it do what it's supposed to do between the interfaces? So those are some of the things we'll cover. Design changes is another one that you'll see in industry, but we don't cover much here, just because most of our products don't get mass produced in that way. Sorry about my voice isn't the strongest today. I've got a little bit of a cold. So we'll talk about setting the path to product success, okay? So all of your projects are creating a product, something that you're going to make and deliver to your community partner, right? Project management sets the path to that success. So you're setting up, what are the steps I need to do to get from where I am today, knowing a problem statement, to having a delivered solution? So you're gonna set that up. This could happen spontaneously, but it's not likely, okay? So a lot of you, if you are into like the maker movement, you like doing robotics or things like that, you might sit down and just tinker and build something, but you're probably not gonna land a shuttle on the moon that way, okay? So some of those bigger projects, when your complexity increases, the probability of it happening organically goes way down. You need to have rigid discipline, make sure that you plan everything out in advance, that you look at contingencies when something goes wrong, okay? So even though it takes time to do project management and you think I could be spending this time doing my design work, it really in the end will shorten the overall time to completion. So we see a lot of EPICS projects that stagnate where they might be 4 or 5 semesters in and they haven't quite gotten over that burden to be delivered. It's almost always from lack of project management where each semester people come in, dive into design, but they don't really think about what are the steps we need to do this and be efficient. So also look at efficient use of resources. So you have a lot of different resources you have to manage on any project team. So you guys all have limited amount of time. It's probably the biggest one on all of your minds, right? You've got 6 classes. This is 1 credit hour and you're trying to balance that. And then as a project manager or a design lead, you have 4 or 5 other people on your team. You also have to manage their time to some degree. And you also have to manage things like your budget, your resources, okay? So see, these are some of the things in project management can help you with. Remember, as a project manager, you're not the boss. So some of you are design leads. You're kind of the local boss of your design, right? You can kind of dictate the way that your design will go. If you're the project manager, that's really not your role. Your role is to lead people and make them move in the right direction, but it's not to tell them what to do or how to do it, okay? So for instance, when I was an engineer in industry, I would have people I was a design engineer. I'd have quality engineer, industrial engineer. We'd have marketing people, regulatory people, all on my team. I was none of their boss, right? because they all had bosses in their department, but I was the lead of the project, so I had to make sure that those people were moving in the right direction, even though I didn't have, you know, hire fire type of authority. So as a project lead in EPICS, it's a lot the same way. You don't have control over the people on your team, but you do have influence. So you're trying to influence everyone to work in a concerted effort. So product scope is a really big deal that really gets overlooked, and it's one way to really derail a project. So project scope is, hi, make sure, it is.
I was in the other one.
Excellent, well, welcome. Are you a returning student?
Yeah.
Good. You would think that the returning students would have a better grasp of where the rooms are, but it's okay. We didn't have any new students accidentally end up here, interestingly. So product scope, you're stating, what is the boundaries of this product, okay? You also have a project scope. So for most of you, your project scope will be your semester scope, okay? So if you had been working on the VOS model, if you guys haven't seen it on the south side of campus, large solar system model, they had a long-term scope to build that model. But each semester, they had to have a shorter-term scope to say, this semester, we're going to get the design of this piece done, okay? Most of your projects are like that. They're large and complex. They'll last for multiple semesters. If you sit down in your project and you just look at the overall scope and you know you won't get it done this semester, you have a sort of ill-defined end point for your semester, then you won't have much to drive yourself to, okay? Having a well-defined goal for the semester you're in helps a lot. So the other thing in product scope is making sure that your feature set is kept to a minimum, because we all get this thing called scope creep. And it's the biggest problem in almost every industry for projects getting done, that you start out with a defined scope. And you say, I'm going to design, like I say here, a smartwatch, okay? I'm going to design a smartwatch, and I want it to be a device that displays time, communicates with smartphones and other functions. So I know I want it to do some neat stuff. It's going to be a smartwatch, right? But you don't know exactly what those functions are. And as you get into it, you have 100 customers in a focus group, and they all tell you different features they want. And what you do is you end up growing and growing and growing the scope of your project until it's so much work you can never get it done. It's too complex, okay? A lot of EPICS projects fall into this. So we were looking at, today in my School for the Blind team, we were talking about a magnifier for people with limited sight. We're saying, what if we had motors move the camera around, things like this? And as you develop that, yeah, those features would be neat and they'd make a better product, but they also make it harder and harder to deliver. So we try and keep it down to a minimum viable product, and then we can build those complexity in later. So for instance, in our smartwatch, instead of saying it will have communications and it will do some other functions, we could be really specific and say it's a wrist-worn device, displays time constantly, could communicate with Android and iPhone, even better if you said it's a particular version of those things. It'll use Bluetooth. If you say the particular kind, it's even better to display current weather notifications, information about currently playing music, right? So those are fairly specific, and you could make those even more specific, right? So the more you drive down to make them specific, the less work you end up needing to do, because you're going to satisfy those very specific things. And the less work you can make yourself, the more likely you complete that work, okay? So I talked a little bit. Scope creep is this sort of uncontrolled change in scope. So you might meet with your customer on your smartwatch and they say, if this thing doesn't have a heart rate monitor, no one will buy it. And people who are in sales are really good at telling you things like that. Like, no one will buy this unless you have this. But if you have the best executed simple device with the minimum feature set that people really require, you'll be better off. So we say, you know, if it doesn't have a camera, no one will buy it. If we don't track steps with it, no one will buy it. Those kind of things will just grow and grow your scope. And you'll see that in design reviews. When you guys do your design reviews, your design reviewers will say, that's neat, it should do this too. And you have to really take a hard look at, is that a requirement? Is that a real user need? Or is that an added function that we don't need? Okay. So we talked a little bit about this product versus project scope. So we might have a semester breakdown. You also might break down on other factors. You might say, you know, over the next 4 weeks, our scope is to get this work done, okay? And that's all we're really going to focus on for now, because we have too many unknowns after that. So that's okay to say, I'm doing a project that I don't fully understand, so I'm going to dedicate this next 6 weeks to doing this work up front that I do understand, and then re-scoping for the rest of the time. Okay. So the more you can break those things down into bite-sized pieces, the more everyone on your team will pull in the same direction and understand the goal you're working to. Okay. Attainable goals are a really good thing. So I think I mentioned this, but really focus on minimum viable product. So that should be like a mantra in your team as you meet, because we are all inclined to look for more neat gizmos that we could put into our products, because it's fun, right? That's the fun part. Like, let's come up with this really big creative solution. But you should always aim for that minimum viable product first, get it to the market. Because when you get your device in its simplest form to your customer, then as they use it, they can tell you what those features they really need are. You know, I love this thing, I use it every day, but I'm really frustrated that it can't do X. Then you know that's that feature you really need, okay? So let them use it and you'll gain so much more knowledge. So I want you to take a little bit of a, maybe 2 or 3 minutes, and just write down the scope for your project. And then after you write that down, think through what your scope is. I want you to hand it off with a partner. I'll give you a couple of minutes and I'll let you know. Hand off with a partner and just read your partner's scope and say, how could I narrow this down and make it more focused? Okay. So go ahead. If you haven't kind of partnered up and reviewed each other's yet, you might do that now. I'll give you just a couple more minutes. Thank you. All right. All right. Hey, did everybody get a chance to kind of talk to each other about your scope? Hey. Hello. Did everybody get a little bit of a kind of drill down on your scope? Did you see how you could, when you look at somebody else's scope, it's a little bit easier to be kind of judgmental and take it down to a narrower level, right? So you can always look at any, even on my example before, I said, you know, you could look at saying, I'm only going to use this for an Android, but you could specify the exact device, the exact model number. So you could get into those more specific details and make sure that things work for your project partner. Does that help a little bit? Make everybody see, if you're working on a project and you don't really understand the scope, how you can kind of keep moving off in random directions. It helps a lot to narrow that down. So some project management tools that you could use for keeping your timeline, simple calendars will work, okay? Not always the best method, but they can be useful. You can look at a PERT chart, which is, it's another nice tool. It's kind of a graphical representation of how a project will flow along. Usually not that detailed because it's graphical, so if you get a lot of details in, your chart gets really huge. A really nice couple of tools we'll use, one is a Gantt chart, and I'll show you those if you've never done one before. This is probably the most commonly used tool that I've seen in practice in industry. It's basically a list of all of the tasks that you're going to do along with how long it's going to take. But it can give you a lot of information. The other one is PIGS, so I think most of you have talked about that a little bit. And we'll talk about those a little bit more. So we'll focus on those two. So a Gantt chart just shows a project's all the tasks, and it also includes dependencies. So dependency means what has to get done before something else can start, or what has to finish before something else can finish, okay? There are some more complicated ones, but those are the most common type. So you know, if you were going to plant a tree, you know, you would say you have to dig the hole before you can set the tree in the hole, right? Otherwise, you don't have the hole there. So you can set those dependencies, and if you know it's going to take you 10 minutes to dig the hole and 5 minutes to set the tree in, then you can see that those flow in sequence, and you've got a 15-minute task, okay? There are other kind of tasks where you can say, this can't finish until something else is done, right? So if you're making dinner, and you're cooking a baked potato and a steak, you can't eat dinner until the potato and the steak are done. Does that make sense to everybody? So you'll see those kind of things a lot. But a Gantt chart will have time along the horizontal axis. So usually they'll be broken out in weeks, but it depends on the length of your project. So if you end up doing these in Excel, which some of you will prefer to do over using something like Project Libre, you've got 16 cells across, one for each week. It's really straightforward. It's not very detailed. So if that work doesn't get done, you know, if you need lots of tasks to happen in 1 week, that's not a lot of detail. But it's very functional and it's easy to read. So people in general are familiar with this 16-week schedule for Purdue. We'll know what you're doing. And then you put the tasks on the horizontal axis or on the vertical axis. So the length of a bar on the graph will show you more or less the duration of that task. So some tasks can be done in parallel, some in series, and that's kind of what we're talking about with finish to start or start to finish or finish to finish. So you can look at what things are done in parallel, what things can't be. So that might be you know, two things physically can't be done in parallel, or it might be one person is responsible for multiple things and just doesn't have the time. So you have to look at that as well. In the beginning of your project, when you're first starting out and you're defining what the project is, these will probably be really coarse, right? So you'll say, we're going to start out, we're going to do brainstorming, and then we're going to do some simple concept design, we're going to prototype, we'll do a detailed design and build, and that might be the whole thing, right? But as you start to understand your project better, you can get into more and more level of detail. And that happens commonly in large projects in industry as well. So usually in the beginning, you're not really sure what's going to happen, and as you work through, you can get into more and more detail. Usually that detail is needed the most at the end anyway, because you'll have a lot of tasks busy at the end when you're trying to build, okay? So this is sort of the look of a Gantt chart. It's compressed a bit, but you can see each of these bars is a task. They each have a duration that goes along the horizontal axis, and you can see there are a lot of dependencies that follow, right? So I will open up Project Libre, just to give you a look at how this works. Oh, here we go. So when you go to create these, usually the first thing I do is hide my timeline because I really don't.